So we have a lot to cover this morning, and so I do want to kind of jump in, and I'm going to try to do several things where we do have a teaching this morning, and I'm going to kind of blend that into what's going on in Texas. So I guess I just want to first give you a quick update. Some of you may have known that I was able to go down to Texas with Scott Martin from Community Covenant Church. And Scott has his own company plane that we were able just to kind of go like that. And it was literally, I think he texted me Tuesday night at like 9 o'clock, and we're going 12 o'clock tomorrow. And I was like, oh, okay. I'm going to talk more about that later because it'll go with the teaching. But just to let you know that we end up going the next morning, which I guess was Wednesday morning, and it's like a seven-hour flight. And we got into Georgetown, Texas, and there is like it's a big, huge hangar, like an airplane hangar, and it's perfect for like storing large supplies. And so I sent some pictures up there. I should have had some on there this morning. That would have been a good idea for you that didn't see that. It's on Facebook. It's so you can check it out. But what happened was there was a church down there named Celebration Church, and I don't know if it's a huge church, so I don't know if it has 10,000 people, 20,000 people, whatever, but it's a big, big, big church. And they had someone from their church that ran this hangar. And then this other woman, Robin, was our main contact. And Robin and Scott had done a lot of work together when Haiti, the crisis in Haiti happened, and Scott was flying in and out of Haiti. And so they had a really good working relationship. And she was just like, she was that tactical person, like on the ground, just coordinating everything, because you can imagine just all the chaos. And so it was just really neat to see that. And so what we did, I really wanted you to get this because like it's very, very different than what we're going to be doing going forward. But like Scott has this phenomenal heart and he loves people very deeply, and he uses how God has blessed him to just go into. We talk about that all the time. Will we step into the darkness? Will we accept that call and just go? And so he used his plane as a huge resource, because if you think about it, with all the water, all the flooding, like even huge tractor trailer trucks could not get in. And so that's why he wanted to leave with that immediacy. It's like, we have to get in there, because after a time frame, it's not going to, you know, the use of the plane is not going to be efficient. You know, it's very, very costly. And so I'm just kind of like, all right, tell me what to do. You know, like, I'll just follow your lead, and we'll figure it out as we go. And so when we're down there, it was like, we got down there kind of late at night, and so it was like 6, 7 o'clock or whatever. So we made one run down into Beaumont, Texas, and from what I could gather after going for a few days, that Beaumont was a part of where the storm had hit pretty severely, but they still had power, they still had water, but they were dealing with all of the flooding, and yet you could get around. And so it was the best place for us to go, because these other airstrips, we just couldn't get in because they were flooded. And so as we went in there, we made one delivery, and just brought in as much supplies as we could, and that you could imagine was some foods, diapers, you know, amenities, just all the different things that we could give. And now the church, which was really cool, was responsible for getting the supplies into the hangar. And the word was, tomorrow morning, so I guess that would be Thursday morning, this place will be filled with goods and supplies. So that night we went in and kind of met some people in Beaumont and kind of got a feel for what was happening there. And it actually got worse overnight, because the next morning something happened to the water system and got contaminated, so they lost the water. And so the next morning we woke up early and went again to Beaumont right off the bat and brought another huge supply, all the different supplies. And then when we got back to Georgetown now, this is where, to me, is very interesting, because like my heart and like how I'm wired is like, I just want to go into where the people are. Like I wanted to be the person in the boat, you know, going from home to home and come in the boat and go, you know, like that's just like how I think I'm wired. And yet on this trip, it was like kind of the back office stuff. Like you're gonna go in, you're gonna drop these supplies off, and then you're gonna come back and just do it again and again and again. So that was what we thought was gonna happen. So when on Thursday though, like I said, that church did an amazing job. I think they spent $40,000, you know, out of their own budget to bring in all these supplies. And they are so resourced. They have the teams in place and just, it's like, go, 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 you know, and they just have everything like this. And so these huge trailers were coming in, and then just the volunteers just were in the hangar, down, you know, getting everything off of the trailer onto pallets. And then we would organize the pallets into like 500-pound pallets with all different, like they'd come in and like all food, all toilet paper, all this, right? So we wanted a little bit of everything to make the trips worthwhile. And then the planes started to come in, and this again blows me away. So these are just like people like you and me that said, I have a plane and I want to help. And it's coming out of their own pockets, and they're just starting to show up. And I don't know exactly how many planes there were, but it was like, it seemed like there was like 10 to 15 planes that just come in, load them up, send them off. Next plane come in, load them up, send them off. And they needed some logistical help. And Scott is just a phenomenal person when it comes to leadership and organization. And he just did an amazing job of like coordinating this. Because this, if you think about it, this hangar is not, this isn't what they do. You know, this isn't what they do on a regular basis. So they needed leadership. And so we were able to just really logistically organize the volunteers, organize the pallets with the food and all the different things, and then make sure that the planes were safe, loaded up, and able to go and make the deliveries. And then afterwards, when that was kind of like systemized, then we were able to take another load ourselves, and then this time we went to Orange, I think it's Orange County, if I'm not mistaken. Some people called it Orange, Texas. And so that was another place that we were able to go into. And so it was a very interesting experience for me personally, where you're going in and it gets a little bit overwhelming, even though I wasn't in the midst of, you know, all the people scrambling. But what you did see was when we showed up at the airports in these different towns, there'd be people from that community there to help. So they'd come with their big, huge dump trucks, right? And this one man in particular, I just want to share this story quickly. He was a young man, and he had a family, he had a wife and three kids. And you could just see like how grateful he was to see people just coming in and doing what we could to make a dent. And he's like, I had to get my family out of here. And I just, you know, here's a few hundred bucks. Go, you got to go. And just to see his gratitude, it's like it's very humbling, and yet I feel like it's something that we need to figure out as a church to be able to share stories that impact us and influence us to move. Because like I share that story, and it kind of gets me like I got to do more. I want to go and help more, and because these people need it, and there's this a closeness, like you just feel connected at a very deep level. Like he just said, he goes, man, if I could just love on you, you know, he's at that southern thing going, I just want to give you a big old hug, you know. and so that was just very, very special. And then there was another plane that was very similar to ours, if not the exact same plane. And when we were trying to organize in the hangar, they came out in a huge family. I don't know if they had 7 people, 10 people, whatever it was, but it was a family that needed to be evacuated. The mom was pregnant. And just seeing them, she was describing the story that she had, like, she's pregnant. She has one baby in her hand. The water's up to her neck. She's just trying to get out. And so it gives you a picture of, like, the devastation that's going on there. And I just feel like we have a responsibility, you know. You've been coming here for a while. You know that I think the church has a responsibility. It's not a nicety. It's not, I hope you. It's you are responsible to bring good news into this world. You're commissioned to do this. If you call yourself a Christ follower, you're supposed to go and make a difference. And we talk about it doesn't have to be in great, big, huge ways. It could be in little, small ways. But this morning, I just wanted to give you a flavor of that a little bit, and then I'm going to shift gears a little bit. And I've been wanting to do a teaching, and it was in that series called Antidotes for the Out of Control Life. And I think it ties together because if you could just put up that slide, Will, that says see clearly, listen carefully. We talked about the importance of building margin into our lives. And if we don't have margin in our lives, we're unable to do those things. But when we have margin in our lives, we're able to see clearly. And what I think what I mean by that is this idea of what's really important. We're able to prioritize and then make decisions out of that because we have the ability to do that now because we have margin. And then the idea of listen carefully, I would suggest it's both vertical and horizontal. It's listen carefully to God and his whispers, bless you, his whispers that he's calling us to be the church in all these different ways. He has the people in your life. Wherever you go, every single day, the people in your life are there for a reason. And you get to choose to play in that or not. And then listen carefully maybe also has to do with the needs around you, right? As you befriend people, you get to know people, you're listening to see what are their needs and how can I help meet those needs. And then we just talked about thinking deeply. How many times do we just get caught up in life that we just go, 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 and we never take time to reflect and think about why we're doing what we're doing and how am I doing at what I'm doing, right? Am I reaching the goals that I have? Are they the right goals, etc.? And then to savor life fully, to me, has to do a lot with purpose, a lot of with mission. Like, if we're going to savor life fully and live it the way that God intended it for us to live and be the fully human, then it's got to be about loving the other. I don't think anyone can argue that when you look at Scripture. And then the last one is to serve God and others effectively. It comes out of that relationship with God where we know that he first loved us, and out of that love, we must love the other. And so we're going to try to figure out how we can serve God and others effectively during this crisis. So hopefully you can kind of see why, how important margin is in a crisis like this, because how are we going to respond? And I just kind of put prayer, our time, our resources, things like that. And if we don't have margin, think about it. Some of us didn't even have margin this week to be in prayer. And I'm guilty of that most times. Like when you see things happen around the world, you know, your life is so chaotic that you don't even take time to pray. You don't even take time to notice, okay? So I'm guilty of that. But I think when we build margin into our lives, we start to recognize what's going on around us. And we're like, all right, God, how can we team up together to make a difference? Which lends itself to, where can I give my time? And we talked about that. Margin also has to do with being able to say no to good things even, to say yes to really great godly things. And this is in no way, I hope you don't get filled with any kind of guilt in this. I get it. My story was, I guess I'm going to jump to it. So I said no to Scott on the front end. I had three, I don't usually have this many meetings, but I had three meetings on that Wednesday. So on Tuesday night when I got the text, I'm looking at my schedule and I'm like, I have three, and I would say important meetings. And then on Thursday, we had a three-hour window of strategic meeting here for the church to kind of be thinking about long-term things. Vitally important meeting to me. and I was thinking about this, and I wanna bring these two things together because we talk about your story matters a lot, and we talk about the importance of story. And I've been thinking a lot about that because as a team, we've been saying it's so important for us to hear what is God doing in your lives? So like, I want to get to the point where every single week when we show up, we'll have some part of the service where it's just, it could be a 1 minute thing, but all of you at some point is going to say, hey, God surprised me this week by, or he used me by, or he did something in my life. Here's what it is. And, or I did this act of kindness, blah, blah, blah. And a lot of times I think we don't do that because we're like, oh, I'm self-congratulating myself. Look at me. Look at what I did today. And I'm like, no, I really want you to get this. I'm going to talk more about this at another series. But I need you to get this. Like, I want you to know, Sarah, and the thing that motivated me was when Sarah and Dave responded to Haiti. And it was on a moment's notice. And Sarah and Dave just said yes. And they rearranged their whole lives to make that happen. And so, thanks. I couldn't sleep that night. So thank you, Sarah. So all night long on Tuesday night, I'm thinking, well, I don't feel right about saying no. And then the whispers, if you will, was saying, we teach about this all the time, that God does some of his best works in the interruptions of life. Right? And so my life was being interrupted, and I had a choice. And it's because of the stories that Sarah and Dave, just knowing their story, knowing that they did that, was inspiring to me. It was motivating to me, saying, look, I can do this. And so if we don't hear those stories, we just stay in our own complacent world. And so I'm kind of like pleading with you to see yourself as a vessel where God is doing stuff in your life all of the time. And we got to be able to capture that. So I hope that I can just go, hey, now's the time to share. And like 50 hands go up. And I go, hey, oh, time out. We only need one today. All right. And the other 49, you can get in the line. Right. That's what I hope happens. You know, not like, all right, let's sit here and wait for one person. That's a little challenge, okay? But I want you to hear that in light of this happening, because it motivated me to say, I'm going to say yes to this. And I'm so grateful that I did. And then I thank the people that had to rearrange the schedules to accommodate that. But truly, we're in this together. And so, yeah, this last part of the series on margin or the antidotes for out-of-control life is on a subject. Well, let me, I don't know if I have this up there, but like one of the things that we talked about was the toolbox. And so because in this series, we talked about the importance of building margin. We talked about the importance of having Sabbath, the rest, the renewal, and the remembering. We talked about the importance of being able to say no. We talked about do what energizes you. And then we talked about remember rule number 6. Anyone remember rule number 6? Don't take yourself so seriously. And Stacy put that up on her work board. I love that. Good reminder at work, right? Everyone, don't take yourself so seriously. So one of the things at Stone Coast that I want to be able to do, because of that, one of our values is just to be real, just to be authentic. And in that, to be vulnerable means we're going to talk about tough topics. And I know that scares some people, but I think like as a church, we have to be able to talk about whatever's going on in life. Whatever people are wrestling with, we have to be willing to enter into those conversations and teach about it. Because I believe that the Bible has so much wisdom on every topic. And so we have to do a good job on that. So today, I'm going to be talking about margin in our finances. And if you're visiting with us for the first time, you know, I just want you to know, you don't know me, I don't know you. We don't talk about finances a lot. I understand that there's a stigma out there. I understand that most people, when they drive by a church, go, they only want my money, all right? So I don't want your money. I want you to figure out how to have margin in your life, because here's what I believe. The Bible has over 2,000 references to money. It's the most talked about topic in all of Scripture. 3 times more than it talks about love. And thus it says, geez, this is pretty important. And I've lived long enough to know, like, yeah, money impacts everything. And unfortunately, a lot of us lose a lot of sleep at night over finances. So the pastor in me says, I want to be able to talk about this so that I can help you. I want you to be able to figure out the freedom that comes by following God. And again, we come about trust. Do I trust him and his ways, or do I trust me and my ways? Now, we don't need stories about this, but I bet you we could all go through life and say, I've been handling finances my way for a long time, and it ain't good. You know, and there's a lot of stories out there. There's a lot of marriages being destroyed over finances, all of these things. And so I hope as a church we can come around in a very healthy way and help you navigate how to manage your finances very, very well. When they do polls on this and they ask people, what are the biggest stressors in your life that keep you awake at night? 75% of the people said finances. And so when we talk about creating margin, I want to not only be able to help you in this, but I think it's also important that we combine it to the mission, okay? So I'm jumping a lot here, so I guess just going to keep jumping. Let's see. All right. So I can go in all different directions. I'm going to go with this one. I just had an awesome conversation with my 19-year-old daughter going back to college, and we had a very in-depth conversation on a couple of issues that really, really matter. And without going into any details, I'll just say the two topics, and then you guys go, oh, crud, that must have been an interesting conversation. But we talked about sex and money. And so it was fascinating to me to hear a 19-year-old's perspective on these things. And I'm the one that brought money into the conversation. You know, we were talking about sex and why does God say, you know, to wait till you're married, all that stuff. And so we had this wonderful, wonderful dialogue. And but then when I was talking to her, I said, we always have choices because a lot of times it doesn't make sense. You know, like this idea of waiting, like she said to me, like I thought it was awesome. She's like, back in the day when the Bible was written, women were getting married when they were 15 years old. You know, the young men, when they just started being able to, you know, their bodies were saying, yeah, we can have sex. It was like they were 14, 15, 16 years old, and then they could get married. So they weren't waiting 15, 20 years. And I thought, oh, that's a really good thought. I'm glad that you're thinking about this and that sort of thing. So then I said something like the idea of, but there's got to be a reason why God does this. There's got to be reasons. And this isn't a sex talk, so I'm not going to go into all this. But I believe. All right, this is what I'm trying to say. I believe, I'm convicted by Scripture that God has our best in mind and He knows best. It took me a long time to get that, and I don't get it right all the time, right? That's why we're all sinners, we all fall short, and we all mess up. But I believe that. And I hope I pass that on to my kids, and I hope that one day they believe that to the core of their being, and that they're working their best to fulfill that. Like, I'm going to trust you, God, even though it doesn't feel right, even though it doesn't make sense to me, even though I don't quite understand why. And so I used money as another way of going about creating a, more of a thought around that, because the Scripture talks about money so much, and I'm like, these are two very, very important areas of our lives that can control us. They can truly take us down. And so when I talk to you this morning, recognize that really at the core of what I'm saying is, do you trust God more than you trust yourself? Do you trust His word more than your own upbringing? More than the things that you've learned along the way? Because I'm not like this. I'm a real guy just like you. I've lived this life and I've learned to go, geez, that one makes no sense at all. You know what I mean? I read the Bible, I go, holy cow, what does that mean? You know, why did he say that? And how did he do this? And so it's a healthy grappling. It's a healthy thing to be, but it's the give and take of, tell me why. I want to keep learning. And so these two topics, this idea of money is something where, fortunately, I'll say, and I won't go too far into this, but when Diane and I got together, we met in high school, some of you don't know that, and so we were dating, and then that was in 1990 that we graduated, and then 1994 we got married. I'm doing really well in the details, and it's been blissful ever since. So finances for us, we never, I don't know that it was ever a big issue, okay? So I recognize that for some of you, it's a huge issue. For us, it wasn't. It never really has. We didn't have anything, so it didn't matter. You know, like when you're 20, I was playing baseball, making 10 grand a year. It was like, awesome, die. Go be a nutritionist because we need help, you know? But we didn't have a lot, so it didn't matter. And then when I started learning what the Scriptures talked about, though, I was like, I need to know more about this. And so very quickly, it talks very simply. It says 10, 10, 80. Give 10%, save 10%, live off the rest. I'm like, huh, all right. Now, it's a lot more complicated than that. But it was something that Diane and I tried to figure out. And we only had a little bit of debt. You know, we had our school payments. And then we had a couple of grand on credit cards. Not too bad. But then we started saying, we want to figure out how can we live as closely to the scriptures as possible. So again, we were just brand new Christians, so we started to tithe, give 10% away. We started to make it a goal. We got to save 10%. We got to pay off all of our debt, right? So we just kept methodically doing that. I'm not sharing that to show off in any way, shape, or form. What I like to say to people is, I don't know how old we were, 20, 23, 24, 25 years old. So we've been doing it for over 20 years now. And I feel I can speak to this. I feel like we've got to a place where we've learned how to create margin in our lives in this area of finances. And I want to encourage you, because when I think about what's happening in Texas, if we have no margin, it makes it so hard to respond, right? I'm going to give you different ways to get involved. And let me see. I got to do some things here. Okay. So at the end, I'm going to talk to you specifically about ways that, if you want to, that you can participate. But let's continue on in this idea of why is finances so important? And to me, it just is human nature, right? Like, I don't know about you, and I'm not going to ask us to raise our hands, but right from the beginning in the book of Genesis, it was like, Adam and Eve, you can have all of that. Like, think about it. It was perfect creation. And you can have anything you want, just not that one thing. And most of us know the story. It's like, the little deceiver was like, don't you want that thing? I think you deserve that thing. I think you will need something even bigger and better than that car that you have. I think you need a bigger home. I think you need a, right? And that voice was even in the garden, just not that one tree. And there's an allure. Now I can't have that. I got to have it, right? Has it changed in 2,000 years? You know what I mean? All of us are in the same boat and go, oh man, I got to have that. And so to me, somehow it's a part of us. And there's a pull, right? There's a cultural pull on us, and it started even in the beginning. So I want to read to you Matthew 6, 19 to 21. Normally we do a public reading, if you will, of Scripture. I'm just not going to do that today. But I do want you to kind of just follow along with me. It says, do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moths and vermin destroy and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moths and vermin do not destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. And here's the key. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And did someone sneeze? Bless you. If at the core of this, when I talk about belief and trust, it comes down to this verse, where it says, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So where you value, the things that you value most, is where your heart will follow. And so I think that God understands us and wired us in a certain way, that he wants our hearts above all else. He doesn't need your money. Trust me, right? It's God of all creation. He doesn't need it. But he wants our hearts. And so if we're staying up late, fretting and worrying and stressing about money, he's sitting there as your loving father, as we sang earlier. It's like, just trust me in this. Do it my way. Create margin in your life. If you figure this out, you'll have peace of mind, which is a huge gift. For any of you that are stressing out and not losing sleep over it, you know that this is a huge gift. If you can figure this out. But then there's this whole other side of living a fulfilled life that's that purposeful, adventurous life that God has for us, that guess what? If you're strapped for money, you're not going to get to it. It goes hand in hand. You cannot get to the things of God that he would love for you to burst forth and do if you're strapped and stressed by money. Okay? Then it goes on in Luke 12. I love this verse, and this is Jesus talking. It says, watch out. Like, it's like, hey, everyone, watch out. You got to see this. Watch out. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed. Life does not consist in an abundance of possessions. And when I saw that verse, I was sitting there going, recognize, I wrote this teaching like 3-4 weeks ago, so now it's shifted. You know what I mean? So now the things that I was going to say, I'm not saying. So what I want to say this morning is this idea of being consumeristic versus missional. Because most of us can buy a lot of things and create some happiness or find some joy or something, right, in that purchase. We kind of feel good about it. It's somewhat empowering, right? After you buy a new car, you feel really good about it. The first few times you drive, and you're like, ooh, the fresh smells, of how it rides. You really like it, right? And I just caveat, no guilt here. If you have lots of money, awesome. Praise God, okay? So it's good to have lots of money. Got it, everyone? It's great. It's a good thing. So no guilt here. This idea, though, about being a consumer or being missional, if we can figure out margin, we can become more missional. That's what I believe. And so that's what I want to help us to get to, and we'll figure that out together. And then maybe the last scripture that I'm going to share with you is from 1 Timothy. It says, true godliness with contentment is itself great wealth. Now, just hang there for a second. That's an awesome verse. You might want to even take a picture of that one. That one is a great verse because how many of us, don't raise your hand, truly have gotten to that place where we found contentment and godliness together, which to me would be maybe like that missional life, and realize the great wealth that that is. After all, we brought nothing with us when we came into the world. Here's some perspective. We can't take anything with us when we leave it. So if we have enough food and clothing, let us be content. So I think there's a challenge in there, right? Just kind of examine a little bit. But people who long to be rich fall into temptation and are trapped by many foolish and harmful desires that plunge them into ruin and destruction. We do this to ourselves. Living in America, this is a constant picture, a constant pull, a constant temptation. This idea of the advertisers, you deserve it, you need it, go after it, get more of it, get more of it, get more of it. But we can fall into the trap. And then verse 10, for the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. And some people craving money have wandered from the true faith and pierced themselves with many sorrows. I just feel like this verse speaks to a real great picture of what true godliness with contentment, what that is and how it produces great wealth. Wealth is not necessarily a number. Wealth has a lot to do with what's going on inside of you, how you're living this life for God. I know a lot of people that make 40 grand a year and live in awesome, blessed lives that just, you know, the fullness of life. And then I know people making $240,000 a year and they're miserable. I don't really think it has a lot to do with the number. But I do, it has to do a lot with your heart. And it has a lot. And then the other thing is the guy making 250 grand a year, if they live like they're making 300,000 a year, they're in trouble. It doesn't matter if you're making, if you live, you make 50 and you live like you're 40, there's margin, right? So we've got to try to figure this out so that we can respond as a church when things like this happen. So here's what I said. I want us to be a church that understands how to build margin in all the different ways that we've talked about it, that we learn how to trust God, that we're willing to take risks, and we're prepared for the storms of life. I mean, there's so much more than this, but if we can get a picture or a better grasp of those things, then we're going to be starting to live more, I think, closer to the heart of God and allow us to be more missional. So with our last few minutes here, I want to talk about maybe some things that we could do. Whenever a crisis hits, it's hard to know how to respond, isn't it? Like, I don't know how many of you have already, I was watching football yesterday, and it's like, oh, you can just press this button and $10 will go to the Red Cross. And, you know, okay, great. You know, and I'm sure some of you, you know, are connected with World Vision and Compassion International, great organizations, things like that. I want you to do whatever you want to do in light of that. So what I'm about to say is just one way of going about this. You know what I mean? If you have a connection with those different organizations, by all means, give to those organizations. But I first want to start with this, and I don't say this lightly, that all of us are in a position to be able to pray. Okay? So all of us can participate in this crisis through prayer. And so, because I don't want anyone to be excluded from this. I don't want anyone to feel like they're less than or they can't participate. All of us can participate. And one of the simplest yet most powerful ways is through prayer. And so if you can commit to, you know, the next, whatever, 30, 60 days, whatever that looks like in your life, and say, every day I'm going to wake up and I'm going to be praying. I'm going to be praying for the local churches here to do what they need to do. I'm going to be praying for the people that end up going. I'm going to be praying for the families that have been devastated. Whatever that prayer life takes on, but there's power in prayer. So commit to that. Financially, again, and there's no pressure at all to give. When I put these things out there, don't feel any pressure. The Bible talks about being a cheerful giver and not to feel pressured to give. And so if you're not in a position to give, do not give. But if you're in a position to give, and this is a way that you feel like God would have you give, then please feel free to do so. And I would like to set a goal of $10,000. And as a church, whatever comes in, great. But because you have all been faithful with giving throughout the year and a half that we've been here, this money's here and ready for that. We have a mission fund. And so I can commit to this, and I'm going to be committing $10,000 to go towards this crisis. And what I want you to recognize is I feel like there's a few different ways that this money could be used. One is, I'm going to say the 3-inch trash pumps, I don't know if you know what those are, but they suck a lot of water up and then pump it out, okay? And I feel like those are going to be very, very much needed in these next few weeks. And so they're about $500 a piece. So I'd like to, we're teaming up with Community Covenant Church on this too. So Scott through there, I know that they're going to be getting some trash pumps, and we'll get some trash pumps, and we'll get them down there one way or another, whether it's through a shipment, which I'm going to get to in a second, or through Scott's plane or whatever. But somehow we're gonna get them to them. So if you wanted to buy those, I could give you. We'll work that out. Just you come see me. I think we found them for $500 or something like that. Like good ones that will do the job. So that's one way. The other thing is, I hope to send some people. I hope that some of you can actually go and help be part of the rebuilding. And so the church that we're teaming up with is called Celebration Church in Texas. And starting this Wednesday, every Wednesday and Saturday, they're sending teams of 10 people. And they're also teaming up with Franklin Graham. Anyone, what's the organization's name? Samaritan's Purse, thank you. So they're going to be teaming up with them to coordinate all of this on the ground. So they have a person that's going to be trained. So say we have 10 people that want to go, we'll meet up with a person from Celebration Church who's been trained on how to do this. They'll take us as 10 people, we'll go into an afflicted area, and we're going to be teamed up with another church that can host us, and then we're going to just, whatever we got to do, rebuild. You know, so they're going to need people in the trade. But I think it's also anyone can go. Like, they'll find a place for us to help. So if that's something that you want to do, I want to be able to help with your airfare. So if you can't, you're saying, I have the freedom to go, but I don't have the money to get there or the whole airfare, I want to be able to help supplement that, okay? So I feel like that would be a good use of the monies. And then, of course, whatever money's left over through supplies, okay? Now, why I'm not putting a big emphasis on the supplies is because I just found out this morning that we can team up with Highlander and Rose, who's the principal here, and we're going to set up a donation station here. I don't know what that will look like. I don't know any of the logistics, but just picture a big, huge container out in the front lawn, and we're just going to try to get all the people in the community from all walks of life to say we want to make a difference. And so we're going to start to engage in that conversation. And so if you can help in this through, you know, people that are truckers, you know, people that do containers, you know, people in advertisement, whatever, like I just want to get the word out so that our communities that want to make a difference and can, we have a supply list. It's online. I have about 25 copies. You don't have to do anything, but those will be available out in the cafeteria if you want to grab one. I only made 25 because it is online. So some of you that don't have computers or whatever. But here's a list, and this list is up to date from Celebration Church, saying, look, we're on the ground. We understand the needs. Here's what we need right now. And they're already, you'll see the list, it's already in the rebuilding stages, right? So that's why this Wednesday, they're already sending out teams of people every Wednesday, every Saturday, just keep bringing in people to help rebuild. I feel like this is going to be a very long endeavor. So you might say to me, in the next month I can't make it work, but maybe 4 months from now you can. Who knows? But we'll just keep the conversation going. So with the container, as we find that out, we're going to need volunteers. So again, maybe you can't give financially. Maybe you can't. If you want to show up for a couple hours and be part of the system of receiving donations and loading up the storage unit, awesome, right? There'll be opportunities. I don't have the details right now, but there's going to be opportunities for you to get involved. And if you want to take that list and go and buy the supplies and drop them off, that's another way you can get involved. So there's a lot of different ways that we can get involved. So next week, we typically, if you've been here for the last year and a half, I don't know if we've ever done this, we're going to take a special offering. And like I said, just on the check, just make it out to Stone Coast, put in the memo, help Texas. That's simple. We'll take all those monies. So whatever comes in next week is going toward that endeavor. And like I said, if it doesn't come up to $10,000, we'll supplement that. But I want to make sure that we are doing everything we can to live out what our mission is. And we talk about that all the time, that we're here to love on people and take care of the needs around us. So, all right, now. So, this is a lot, I know. We are forming a thing called Town Square Partners. There'll be more information to come on this as we have more details. But some of you know that we talked about starting a business several months ago. And we were talking to Leonard's Antiques, is that right? Leonard's Antiques and Seekonk. And we thought we were going to land there. Like it was like moving that way. We met with the town. Ian did a phenomenal job meeting with the town, getting everything done with the drawings and all the stuff. The town was yes, yes, yes. I'm going to meet with the owner at Leonard's to literally receive the lease agreement, and all we had to do was figure out the utilities part of it. I'm like, this is good. This is awesome. I show up at that meeting, and curveball. As a baseball player, I don't like curveballs. So here it is. She's like, we're moving. Oh, awesome. What does that mean to us? Long story short, we are unable at this time to lease that space. So they have not been able to give me a definitive time frame. It's been frustrating. Kara's come on board here, as many of you know, to help launch this business concept, and also subsequently this idea of Town Square Partners of leading that. And so I said, Kara, just start looking elsewhere. You know, I mean, like this, whatever happens here, fine. I don't think we can wait 6, 12 months, a year and a half, because they were that vague. It was like, it could be 12 months, could be 18 months, could be 24 months. All right, let's go. So we're in the meantime, we've been looking at other spaces. We have one. I can't go into it, but we look like this one's very, very favorable. Why I'm saying that now is because some of you might not know, the reason why we want to start a business is we're building off the concept of a church in Mendon, Mass., who has a blessing barn. And quickly, the blessing barn last year was able to, after they paid off everything, it's a nonprofit, they were able to give back about $240,000 back into the community to meet felt needs. Okay, so they're developing margin, if you will. They're creating margin so that they can answer the call. So think about that. If we had $240,000 going to all these local needs, but hey, all of a sudden there's a thing happening in our country or internationally, we can respond in a pretty robust way. And so I'm very excited about that. And I as we get details, there'll be plenty of opportunities to volunteer in that endeavor too. But I just want you to kind of get a picture of why I think the scriptures talk about finances in such a powerful way. It's not just about me as an individual. It's so much bigger than that, okay? It's that and then all of these other things. And so we are going to be able to do some great things, and we're going to partner with all different, anyone that wants to partner with us, basically. So please be keeping that in prayer. Next week, if you'd like to be part of the special offering, take advantage of that. You have the list of items if you want to start doing that. It's also online. I guess I'll leave you with this. If you know now that you just, you know, your chest is pounding and I got to be a part of this, hang around afterwards. We'll go down into one of the classrooms and we'll talk for a little bit more about that. I don't have a ton of details, but I'd like to know whose hearts are racing right now. And I want to know who's like, I want to do something. I don't